First of all, can you just tell us, well, Andy, a little bit about the group itself?
Well, there's four of us. Oh, no, there's one missing. There's three.
Yeah.
And we've been together just over 2 years now. We are having most of our success in England at the moment. We've had success in America, and we're working here on tour now to try and consolidate.
Right. Now, how hard has it been sort of for you for the first year, to sort of like, you know, with so many groups around?
I don't know, we've been very lucky. The first year together was very difficult, like virtually nothing happened. The ball really started rolling for us when we came to America just over a year ago, last October. And we had initial success here in the clubs, and Roxanne was released, and the ball started rolling quite quickly. And that that success bounced back to England,
right.
and it just took off very quickly after that. We're having a great time.
Now,
not again.
Control yourself. How do you sort of see music in the last 2 years before we go on to the last 10 years?
It's been a very exciting time when everything has turned around and changed, and a lot of old faces have sort of been scared to death by the new groups. It's a time where a new group can come out and make some new sounds and be accepted almost instantly. It's a nice time to be making music. And I just hope it doesn't close up too quickly, because it will do.
Right. Well, was Roxanne Sting initially structured as a single, or was it just a track off the album?
Initially structured as just a song, and then we didn't actually realise its potential until our manager came and heard it, and we freaked out, and we were sort of puzzled by his sort of enthusiasm, and then the more we listened, the more we thought, God, this is good. We didn't know.
Manager.
We didn't know it.
He wasn't really our manager until he heard that, because in the very beginning, we were kind of regarded as a bandwagon punk band, and we never were a punk band. We wanted to play to the new wave audience, just the new generation of kids who happened to be punks. And when Roxanne came out, it was very clearly showed that we were nothing to do with punk, but we were definitely a new group. Our first album was a hit album, and many other groups, I suppose, would have tried to duplicate their first hit and have another hit, but we didn't. And we went in with an irresponsible attitude towards it. We just wanted to make another album that was different. And it turns out that that's a hit too. Our third album will take some more chances, and maybe that won't be a hit. Maybe we won't be lucky. But we're still after just making good music.
I change my clothes 10 times before I take you on a date. I'm in a cold sweat. My panic makes me late. I know you never meant for this. I know my shots will always miss.
Both the albums have been basically fairly simple, haven't they, in terms of their production? I mean, are you going to continue with that?
Well,
more
we
basic?
Have no.
We don't have to do anything.
We're not committed to any policy as such.
Our new album, Regatta, is actually more sophisticated, more complicated. There's more recording procedure involved, but it took us less time to record.
Right.
We're just much better at it. We know each other musically, and so we can get our ideas across and work things out much faster. Because we've dispensed with a lot of the waffling around. So although we've spent less time on the new album, we actually accomplished more on it.
Hey everybody, welcome back. This is part two of my Police Deep Dive series, and today I'm going to be talking about this phenomenal album, their second album, Regatta de Blanc. I am such a huge fan of this record, not just this record. Truthfully, I'm a fan of all the Police albums, but so excited to talk about this record. Regatta de Blanc was recorded from February to August 1979 at Surrey Sound Studios, where they recorded Outlandos D'Amour and produced by Nigel Gray. The band had written little new material since their debut, and when it came time to record, found they were significantly short on songs to fill the album. Sting and Stuart Copeland resurrected old songs they had written prior to the Police and used elements of them to create new songs. Much of the lyrics to Bring On the Night were taken from a song Sting had written with his previous band, Last Exit, entitled Carry On, Prince, O Ye of Little Hope. Bed's Too Big Without You was also a composition that dated from his time with Last Exit. Does Everyone Stare was built around a piano piece Stuart Copeland wrote in college. No Time This Time was previously the B-side to So Lonely in November 1978 and was added to fill out the album. Despite the patchwork nature of the songwriting, the album would top the UK charts as well as hitting number one in Australia and the Netherlands. So this album starts off with Message in a Bottle, and I consider this to be one of the greatest singles of all time.
I never dictate what the message of any song is. Some people might have an interpretation that is different to mine, but it's just as relevant. So I never contradict people when they say, oh, this, the song means this to me, because it's, that's their meaning. For me, the song means many things. It's a song about alienation and loneliness, and yet the realization that all of us are in this situation makes us less lonely. That's the real message in a bottle.
I hope that someone gets my message in a bottle, yeah.
It's got a fantastic guitar lick, great guitar work from Andy Summers, and it's got a fantastic lyric from Sting. Everything about this song works, and I love even the coda, Send It On an SOS. I mean, every part of it. It's the verses leading right into the chorus, which is one of the catchiest choruses you will ever hear.
I'll send an SOS to the world. I'll send an SOS to the world. I hope that someone gets mine. I hope that someone gets mine. I hope that someone gets my message in a bottle.
I love how it moves from the verses to the chorus and then into that message in a bottle piece and then back into the main guitar riff into the verses. It's structured so well. It is such a masterpiece of a song and a great way to kick off the album. Then we've got the all-group composition, Regatta de Blanc, which is another great. I love the Police instrumentals, and this was their first instrumental, but it worked so well, and it was something that I believe was built up in the studio. It's such great ensemble playing, and everybody is just at the top of their game. Then we've got one of the, it sounds very much punk. This would have fit right at home on Outlandos D'Amour. It's All Right For You. It's just a great kick-ass rock song. The verses are so punk, and the chorus is just a great classic rock chorus. It's a heavy driving rocker, and it is just flawless. Then we've got the moody, bass-heavy Bring On the Night. I love the guitar arpeggios from Andy Summers. I love Sting's bass work. The drumming on it is great. Everything falls together for this song. It is just a gorgeous piece, one of the highlights of the album. And then the last track on it is Death Wish, which has got a reggae flavor to it. It is so awesome. And then it kicks into high gear.
Do I take up and too fast? Just one that could be my last.
so many magical moments on this album, and on Death Wish, it's one of the, I think, under-recognized songs on this album, but it's just a standout track. And the first side of this album is perfection. Side two opens up with the classic Walking on the Moon, and it's really a study in simplicity. There's not a lot of production on this song. You know, it's not overly complicated, but I love that guitar. And you can tell anytime you hear an Andy Summers guitar, like, you know immediately it's him. I love the sparseness of the arrangement on this song. Everybody knows their place. Everybody in the Police is working in the service of the song. They're not trying to show off. They're not trying to be flashy. They're not trying to overcomplicate the song. And Walking on the Moon is just a perfect example of everybody adding just the right amount to perfect the song.
The other ones are complete bullshit.
On Any Other Day has a snotty frat rock feel to it. Seems like an inside joke, almost like they were trying to write a punk song and then it kind of veered off into the juvenile territory. And it's a Stuart Copeland song. They needed material, so this found its way onto the album. I don't hate it, but I do think it's kind of a weak point on the album. You got a Stuart Copeland vocal, which is interesting to hear. I can't remember the next time that he lent a vocal onto a Police album, but there you have it. And back in the 70s, you were expected to put an album out every year. There was not any question of taking a couple years off to take a break from touring, to write some new material. That wheel was always in motion. You had to tour, then you had to write for the new album, then you had to record the new album, then you had to tour the new album, then you had to write the next album, and then you had to record that album, and then go on tour. It was like this machinery that was constantly in motion. So I don't begrudge them the fact they didn't have any new material. It's not any kind of a slight. The pressure back then to keep putting product out was enormous, particularly when your records were hitting. So the next song that we have is The Bed's Too Big Without You, another highlight on the album. I love the bass rhythm. The bass just carries it. But you've got this guitar noodling from Andy Summers that is just so perfect. The drumming from Stuart Copeland is just very light, but it's the perfect blend. And I love that bass rhythm. Everything about the song is just fantastic. And then Contact, and people, anybody who hates on this album, they always point to Contact or they point to the Stuart Copeland compositions on here. Contact was one of my favorite songs as a kid from this album. I just love that guitar lick from Andy Summers that carries it. I love that bass that sounds almost like a tuba right before the chorus of Contact. I've got a lump in my throat about the note you wrote. I'd come on over, but I haven't got a raincoat. I'd come on over, but I haven't got a raincoat. But I just love the thickness of that bass. I love that part where it picks up, that section of it where it gets a little bit faster. But it's just a great pop song. I love it. And then Does Everyone Stare, with that rudimentary piano opening, and then it goes right into the beat, and it's just a great pop song. And, you know, people point to it as a weak song. I disagree. I love the second side of this album. And then the final song is No Time This Time, another great punk rocker. Again, could have fit easily on Outlandos de Amor, but you've definitely got that punk flavor there mixed with new wave. And it's a great album closer. It's so high energy, it's so up tempo, and it just draws to a close one of the most rewarding albums in the Police's career. And they had so many more. It's not even my favorite. It's probably my fourth favorite, but it's still an amazing album. But it just goes to show how great their catalog was. So I already showed my vinyl copy of the album. This is the cassette that I have. And there's really nothing on the J card. Hardly anything in terms of credits. And then I've got the original CD release. I don't have the remastered CD, but that's all I got. Hope you've enjoyed this episode. Hope you're enjoying the Police Deep Dive series. And we'll be talking about Zenyatta Mandata. A great album, but we'll get into that next. Take care.